then I also ended up doing the monitoring for what we all think of as the Berkeley Pit as a consultant. I ended up working for Montana Department of Environmental Quality from 2004 until 2014, so, no, 2015. And I worked on a few priority soils. I'm wearing this sweatshirt, and I'm going to take it off in a second, because this is a multimedia presentation. And the first part of the presentation is my sweatshirt, and I'm going to kind of end with this. This is the Clark Fork Watershed Education Program, and it's housed up at Tech, and it tries to teach really what this watershed is all about. So excuse me, this probably makes some noise. I'm a geologist, not an engineer. Please don't make the mistake of calling me an engineer. This is Tony Incashola. He is a Salish elder. And the story, as far as we can tell, really starts back with an oral tradition or oral history that's been passed down by the Salish. And Tony's going to talk about what he knows from this oral history about Silverbow Creek. But importantly, the Salish have a claim on Silverbow Creek because it was listed in the 1865 Hellgate Treaty. So let's let Tony do a little talking here for a second. Yes. There we go.
And you get to a place what is now Butte. They call Butte an area they call Sintache, which is in translated means a place where you shoot something in your head. And the story goes.
So I didn't know how well you could hear that, but he's telling the story about Sintache, which was the name of the Silverbow Creek, where I didn't know if you could hear that well, where they called it the place where you shoot something in the head. And what they were talking about was harvesting huge bull trout out of Silverbow Creek. So that's, you know, that's as far back, I guess, in history as we can go. So I like this choke because it fits a lot of trying to work in Superfund. You know, there's simple answers and complex answers. And of course, the people thinking the simple answers but wrong answers are falling off a cliff. You know, you could say the devil's in the details. I'd rather say God's in the details and the devil's in the simple answers. But this story about Silverbow Creek, or what I'm going to present, includes science, law, and history. Of course, law, because Superfund is a law, and it really governs a lot of what goes on. So we all know what Butte's all about. I mean, start out with 23 billion pounds of copper. And we all know we need mining. But for Butte in particular, I think one of the worst decisions that was made was ARCO's decision to turn off the pumps, because we lost access to a vast resource of copper. It's been estimated that 2/3 of the original copper is still left in the ground. So it was a betrayal for Butte, for sure. But what we're left with, can you imagine a better place to put them on? Would you rather put it in some pristine area? In Butte, we've already got a mine we're going to live with forever. The groundwater is going to have to be managed forever. And of course, it makes up 23% of our economy. So let's go to the bigger picture. You know, it's often said, I've even heard it said, the Berkeley Pit is the largest Superfund site in the nation. Well, not really true, but if you put the whole complex of Superfund sites together, that probably is. I mean, it still might be arguable, but you have three sites. They start out with Silverbow Creek Butte area, then there's the Anaconda smelter site, and by the way, this green area is way too small. Now it's more like that. And then you have the Clark Fork and Milltown Dam site. So that's huge. So every one of these huge sites gets broken into smaller units called operable units. And Silverbow Creek Butte area has six of them. So here's the watershed. You know, here's Blacktail Creek meets old Silverbow Creek. Comes down along here, and it ends actually right up here where Warm Springs Creek meets Silverbow Creek. So the lowermost of the operable units is the Warm Springs Ponds. And interestingly enough, the first of the ponds was put in place by the Anaconda Company in 1911. I don't know if it was just that they thought, boy, sending tailings down the Clark Fork is a bad idea, or whether it was the lawsuits they are already facing. But anyways, they started them. There's no final decision for the Warm Springs ponds. They were upgraded in the 90s by ARCO, so they would add lime, and they upgraded the dams. But they've left the decision of what finally to do with the Warm Springs ponds until after we make sure that all of the rest of this is as cleaned up as it's going to get. So the next part is streamside tailings. It's Silverbow Creek from the Warm Springs ponds all the way to the edge of Butte. And of course, right now we're dealing with making final decisions on Butte priority soils. It's this red line right here. We're all aware of the Berkeley Pit, which is actually called Butte Mine Flooding. Then there's the West Side Soils Operable Unit. It's actually not on the west side. It was originally called Non-Priority Soils. And it's just become the thing that they can say, well, that's outside of Butte Priority Soils. We'll take care of it later. And the last one I have is called the Active Mine. So MR's mine up here is an inactive Superfund site because it's being permitted and managed environmentally by the state of Montana. If and when MR closes, then it'll be reassessed of whether it's really going to be addressed as a Superfund site or whether the bonding and whatever else in place will handle it. So I'm talking about a stream, I'm talking about Silverbow Creek, so I wanted to talk about what really makes up a stream. To start with, you have some kind of upstream flow, unless you're at the very, very, very headwaters, top of the headwaters. And in our case, we're talking about Blacktail Creek is the in-stream flow. We're also going to look at and discuss groundwater input to the stream. And then there's stormwater runoff to the stream. So all of those make up water in the creek, of course. The stream can be at a fairly low level, we'll have a big storm event, and the water levels will rise, and the stream, we've all seen this, and then it falls back down fairly rapidly. And in Butte, a big part of the story of Silverbow Creek is our sewage treatment plant. And that treatment plant was just upgraded. 2016 was the first kind of shakedown year to see how everything works. It was upgraded to take care of nutrients, not metals, which is what most of this story is about. But we'll keep it in mind. So there are kind of different parts to what you can, there's different levels of success you can have in this story. This is Silverbow Creek. The gentlemen there are with Fish, Wildlife, and Parks, and they're doing a fish count survey. So they're electroshocking. Streamside tailings in Silverbow Creek are largely restorable. You can see this looks pretty good. It looks like a stream. More importantly, there's parts that will never, ever be what they were again. The Berkeley pit and the 10,000 miles of underground mines attached to it will never be fixed. Those are called novel ecosystems. It means it's pretty much a human-constructed ecosystem at this point. The reason that the EPA made this decision is called, they looked at it, it's called a technical impracticability evaluation. So the first thing they looked at is, could we take care of the source of the contamination, which is the rest of the ore body, that two-thirds of the copper still left in place. Well, that would require a pit 65 times larger than the Berkeley. So pretty ridiculous, right? The next two things they really looked at was, well, what if we injected cement or grout into the entire system and just filled it up? Or what if we injected lime and neutralized the acidity of that water and stopped leaching the metals? And we're talking between $9 and $13 billion. And that's without having much of a guarantee that it would really work in the long term. So that was all considered technically impracticable. The next thing they were left with is, well, we cannot allow the Berkeley pit to poison Silverbow Creek anymore. We will have to pump and treat this water. So they can pump and treat it. And the Berkeley pit and the underground mining system has been filling with groundwater. And so is what they need to do is just pump that water so it never gets to the point where it'd be released downstream. And that will have to go on in perpetuity. And you know, I'm a geologist, that's my training. And in this case, in perpetuity is not just a legal term. I'm telling you, we're talking geologic time. So then there's other parts that are really in Superfund limbo. And I already talked about the Warm Springs ponds. They're not going to make a final decision on them until Silverbow Creek is adequately cleaned up. So it's in limbo. I would say right now, Butte Priority Soils is somewhat in limbo. There was a record of decision by the EPA which said what they really need to do for their cleanup. That will be modified, I'll guarantee that. And they're working on this last part in confidential meetings. So all of the science that is currently in motion and the decisions that will be made based on that science are being withheld from us, the public. Is what they will end up doing is they'll all agree. So for consent decree, consent means consent by all parties, which includes EPA, Montana DEQ, Montana Natural Resource Damage Program, Butte Silverbow Government, and of course Atlantic Richfield. And actually there's one other party that we hardly ever talk about, and that's the railroad. So we'll talk about this. Here's Blacktail Creek coming into it. First of all, this is the outline of Butte Priority Soils, this red line. Here's the Berkeley pit. So here's what used to be called Metro Storm Drain. It's now called Upper Silverbow Creek. At the confluence of the two, we now have Silverbow Creek. During normal flow conditions right now, all of the water in the creek is coming out of Blacktail Creek. So anyways, that kind of sets the stage of where we are in this, in the process of Superfund. So we have miners, you know, discover gold in Silverbow Creek, and they work their way upstream to Butte, and they realize there's a huge lode deposit here. And so by 1885, here's the picture of Silverbow Creek with mining claims put on it. So here's Silverbow Creek down here, and there's Blacktail Creek coming in. Interestingly enough, this little branch up here is called Dixie Creek. This one's called Yankee Doodle Creek, and then when they come together, it's called Silverbow Creek. Oh, yeah. And so we started with Sintatke, this pristine river, and we soon had mining imposed on it. So this is from a 1948 aerial view of Butte, and this is sort of what was left from all the previous mining. So here's Silverbow Creek. Some important points along the way. Here's the Parrot tailings, this white area here. Here's this. Here's the Civic Center. This is called the Diggings East. And we have Butte Reduction Works and the Colorado tailings. They usually show up as these whitish areas because tailings are kind of white and nothing grows on them. Oh. So the way this talk, the way this talk is kind of organized from here is we're going to start out and talk about tailings. And tailings are just, you have ore, you grind it up, you extract a concentrate out of that, and that goes to a smelter. And what you're left over with are tailings. The tailings still have quite a bit of acid-producing material, mostly pyrite. And they also have a lot of metals left over, so that they can produce toxic conditions. Then we're going to go to groundwater, which is very specific to the Butte discussion, and stormwater, which also is very specific to the Butte discussion. So here we are in 1898, a USGS map. We can see Silverbow Creek starts up here, comes down along here. Again, here's Blacktail Creek coming in. This is the Montana, That one's the Montana ore processing smelter. And then the Parrot smelter sits right there. So you'll notice that they've dammed up Silverbow Creek into a series of ponds. That was because these mill smelter operations needed water to operate, so they didn't want the water just passing by. They built these ponds, and tailings tended to settle out. So here's what the side of the hill used to look like. This is Meaderville, and the Berkeley pit ends up being taken out the side of this hill. We're probably, whoever took this photograph would be standing in the Berkeley pit of today. But we can see, you know, head frames with a shaft and then a big pile of waste rock right by the shaft. Here's another one. But we also have some kind of smelter complex right in here. Well, the smelters in those days just used Silverbow Creek as an industrial sewer. So down here at the bottom is Silverbow Creek. And again, it's got that white color because nothing's growing there. And the tailings are fairly white. Another picture, this is Butte Reduction Works. So here's Silverbow Creek, and here's the tailings impoundments on both sides. And they've taken out some of the cribbing, so they're allowing the water that decants off the tailings to go right back into the creek. 1908, we have the largest flood of record today. And this is Milltown Dam, which has been removed, and Clark Fork down there has been restored. But a dam's not supposed to operate with water running over the top of it. It was fairly amazing they didn't lose the dam, but here's the powerhouse. and you can see the power of the storm, but this was just moving all those tailings downstream. It's kind of like flushing the toilet and sending it all downstream. So what happened to all those tailings? Well, right here in Butte, we have the Colorado tailings right in the floodplain, and here was the Colorado smelter, so they used to just slurry all their tailings down into the creek. Here's the creek itself, comes down here and right around the tailings. This is what it would look like. This is what it looked like. When I first came to Butte, this is what it looked like. And so you had this waste area, all tailings, nothing growing. You can imagine when it rained, what happened. You had all of that stuff washing straight off of there into the creek. At this point in time, there's also groundwater going right into the creek. So here's the cleanup. First of all, you dig out all of those tailings. They had left at this point this little pedestal around these monitoring wells. So here's the thickness of the tailings down there. Here's the soil underneath, and it's nice and black. We always, maybe it's speculation, but it's an educated guess that this is probably all beaver ponds down here. And so that's very organic, thick, organic, rich deposit. So once you, by the way, the water you see there is really your chance to see what the water table looks like. That's all it is. They had to excavate down below the top of the water table. So then you bring in clean soil and you start rebuilding a creek. Interestingly, ARCO was doing this portion. It was their design. And they were building in the wet, it's called. So they brought in their soil, they were dealing with a live stream in the middle of this, and so they've put rocks along here, and rocks along here, they got hay bales on this bend, rocks here, and they're placing a core fabric log, which is a cocoa fabric, and you can plant stuff in it, and it degrades over a short period of time. They're trying to protect these millions of dollars worth of clean soil they've brought in. 1998, students down from Butte High, we had them down on the creek looking at bugs and looking at what was going on. You can see the little willows that are started here. You can kind of see seed rows over there where they planted grasses. And here's what we have today. I mean, this was in 2006. Still looks like a creek's supposed to look.
Joe, is that picture the way it looks in the Colorado tailings area?
Yes, that's specifically right in the Colorado tailings.
Yeah.
So that was done by ARCO, that cleanup. I want to talk about one piece that's been done by the state of Montana. So in 2002, the state began 24 miles of stream cleanup. And this is the worst area they did by far. This is Ramsey Flats. So again, you can see the thickness of the tailings here right along Silverbow Creek. You can see it's kind of desolate. This is a view, this is Mount Hagen. This is Ramsey Flats, and you notice the nice blue color. Those are copper salts. So again, I would ask you, salts are salts. They dissolve readily in water. So I ask you, what do you think happens when it rains on that surface? There are huge, deadly spikes of copper in the creek. So 2000 to 2015, they started their cleanup. They were working in the dry. So here we have the live creek over here. And they've cleaned up this area off the creek, and they're building the stream channel right there. So once they've built the stream channel, they'll take the water and turn it into the new channel, and then they come back in and they clean up where the channel was. That's called working in the dry. It seems like it makes a lot more sense, but the science of restoring a creek has moved a long ways from when the state started and from when ARCO started back in 97 till today. I mean, there's a lot to it. It's a very complex thing. So this is what Ramsey Flat looked like in 2000. This is Brown's Gulch coming in. And this is what it looks like today. Here's brown gulch coming in and on the ground. This is what it did look like with Brown's Gulch, Silverbow Creek. This is what the confluence looks like today. So now let's move on to groundwater. You guys kind of have an idea of what tailings and streamside tailings is all about. Let's look at groundwater. So this is pump station at the high ore. It's at 2,800 feet below the collar or the surface. So those are a lot bigger pumps than I've ever worked with. Those are pretty huge pumps. Here's what it looked like outside of the high ore. This is a flume carrying water. So from 1870s to 1982, when ARCO turned off the pumps, they were pumping water to dewater all of the mines. And of course, that included the Berkeley pit when it came along in 1955. They were pumping approximately 8 cubic feet per second, which is big. That's about the size of Blacktail Creek in the summer. And that was very acidic mine water, and it was loaded with metals. So when you think about the Berkeley pit, don't forget that there's 10,000 miles of underground workings. And so here's the bottom of the pit. They go down quite a bit further. So the Mountain Consolidated Mine is the one that goes a mile deep and grants us our claim to a mile deep and a mile high. And everyone's on the level. So in 1955, the big veins played out, and they're trying to figure out how to mine low-grade ore. And they started in on two projects. There was block caving and the Berkeley pit, and the Berkeley pit just turned out to be the most cost-effective way to go. So here's very early Berkeley pit. If you know what the size of the haul trucks are today, I mean, you can see that the Berkeley pit, it was pretty small at this point. So then it grew, and it grew, and it grew. So, you know, currently it's about a mile and a half long and a mile across. But you got to ask, too, once they started the Berkeley pit, what happened to all the waste rock? Because there's still waste rock when they're doing a pit. There's rock that's not economic that they just got to get out of the way. And you also need to ask the question, they stopped sending the ore directly to Anaconda for processing. They only sent the concentrate. So I think it was in the early 60s they had the concentrator built. You got to ask, where did all the tailings go? So here's Silverbow Creek coming down here. Here's these ponds. This is constructed from that 1898 USGS map. Here's the Big Butte. Here's Missoula Gulch. Here's where the Berkeley pit will be. Well, is what they did with all that waste rock and all those tailings is they filled up the valley. So this is the rim of the Yankee Doodle tailings embankment. It's not really a dam because it's not holding back water. It's holding back tailings and water. So they're relatively solid. All this out here is additional waste rock sort of buttressing that up. So here's what Google Earth, anyways, this is what it looks like. And these were from Google Earth elevations. So I came up with the dam is about 700 feet high. So you can imagine 700 feet of tailings right behind this dam. And then it kind of tapers off to the north, the thickness of the tailings. So you guys already know what we're supposed to do. We're gonna pump and treat when they need to. And so EPA created this thing called the critical water level. And the critical water level says that water can't go beyond that. That's when they'll have to start pumping, or sometime before that. Actually, it's critical mostly to ARCO, because if it surpasses that level, they will have to start paying daily fines, big fines. So it's actually a fairly safe water level. It's by different calculations, anyways, it's close to 80 to 100 feet below where we would, where water would actually overtop the pit. It's at least 100 feet below where it would overtop the pit, but it's 60 feet below where you would start losing water to the aquifer downstream. And it was kind of a little bit ironic, wasn't it? 1982 on Earth Day, they shut off the pumps. So, you know, this was taken a few years back. This was when I was still an ARCO contractor running around the mine measuring water levels, looking back to the west. And this bench now is now covered. So this is what the history of the rise of water in the mines turns out to look like. And Ted Duane at the Montana Bureau of Mines and Geology thought, wow, they turned off the pumps. We need to start measuring this. So he started going over to the Kelly mine and measuring the rise long before it entered the Berkeley pit. So thank you, Ted Duane. So it, you know, it jumps up here really quickly. You're starting at about 2,000 feet elevation, and within months it's at 3,000 feet. Well, that rapidly tapers off. That's, I think of the Berkeley pit, you guys probably don't think of it this way, I think of it as a very, very, very large well. And when you pump a well for a long period of time, and then you turn off the pump, you'll get a curve like that of the water rising back in the well. But in this case, you also add in this vast expanse of open space, the Berkeley pit. And so that added a whole lot of slowing down to the rise rate.
I have a question.
Yes?
That one's 19 years old. Do you have the current one?
No, I don't. I had to go back and dig different things out of different places. And I wish they would put the whole thing on the pit watch site, but it doesn't go back very far. So here we are currently. This is the treatment plant, and it's called Horseshoe Bend Treatment. This is while it was still under construction. It's been operating. It's only treating some water that flows out from under that tailings impoundment dam called the Horseshoe Bend Flow. And all of that water is being used in the mine. It's been tested in part. It's never been fully tested. And we now know that it probably won't meet several of the standards that will be required. And we also know that it probably doesn't have the capacity to treat all the water that they now understand that will need to be treated. That is being worked on, but maybe even partially a cautionary tale about consent decrees. Because mine flooding went through the consent decree process. So EPA, the state, and ARCO, and Montana Resources all agreed on what the remedy is and what the schedule is. And so although EPA thought maybe they should start a little sooner on upgrading this treatment plant, ARCO came back and said, hey, we signed an agreement on a schedule and we don't have to start the upgrade yet. I do know also that ARCO is looking at what other technologies they may need. So here's what it looks like today. This was taken by space shuttle astronauts. Of course, the Berkeley pit. Here's the new continental pit. Here's the concentrator. All the concentrate goes overseas. I think it's probably all going to China right now. Here's the expanse of the Yankee Doodle tailings pond. The lake at the backside is fed by both the water that decants off the tailings. So the tailings are put in here and they start depositing tailings and then the water runs off. It's also fed by Upper Silverbell Creek, Yankee Doodle Creek, or Yankee Doodle Creek and Dixie Creek. So you got some idea what's going on with groundwater. So that groundwater obviously was just normally part of what fed Silverbow Creek before mining started. And that groundwater then was pumped out of the mine, so it made its way to Silverbow Creek. Once they shut off the pumps, though, it was no longer going to Silverbow Creek. It's gone to filling up the pit. So at some point, that water will be treated and it will become part of Silver Bow Creek, right? Again. But right now, it's just going to filling up 10,000 miles of underground workings in the Berkeley. But there is also this groundwater divide. So everything on the north side is going into the Berkeley. Everything on the other side is groundwater that drains to Silver Bow Creek. So let's go back and look a little more about this groundwater on the other side of the divide, on the Silver Bow Creek side of the divide. We originally had the Colorado tailings here, and here was Silver Bow Creek going right around it. Also, our sewage treatment plant right there. So this is what it looks like today. There's now a channel, because groundwater used to effectively just go right to the creek from the hill. So they just put in this channel that went down into the top of the water table and effectively captures that contaminated groundwater and sends it to this pond here. And that's pumped up to a lime addition station right here. And then that flows down into this series of three ponds. Each series has three ponds. You can see the light color. That's because the lime is precipitating out metals and it's got little particles in there that reflect light and make it look green. But this has been a very, very effective system. It's almost always is meeting standards. The one thing they have a little bit of trouble with is getting the pH back down below 9.5, which is required. So let me explain the rest of the groundwater situation. So just to orient you, this is Montana. And so here's the Berkeley pit up in the corner. This large brown area here is what EPA declared was technically impractical to clean up the groundwater in that area. So a lot of the wastes are left in place, especially up in here, and I'll get to that a little bit more. But the EPA required a separate groundwater capture system here along the old Silver Bow Creek, what's now called Upper Silver Bow Creek. And it's a sub-drain, so it's underground, it's buried, you can't see it, but it captures a fair amount of very contaminated groundwater. One thing you'll note, though, is there's a gap between the two. Is what EPA did say in their record of decision was contaminated groundwater cannot adversely affect the stream, meaning that further actions might be required of ARCO if it is affecting the creek.
I had a question. Can you just show me where, like, the Butte High School would be? I'm not with your pointer.
It's right up in, is that it? I think that's it. Yeah, that's
yep.
So, and it's good to point out reference places. So part of that area where there's no groundwater capture is this slag wall canyon. So this Silver Bow Creek running through there. That was another part that was required in the record of decision that still hasn't happened yet, is they said you gotta remove the sediments, and this is a little inset floodplain now. That all needs to be removed, period. There were no ifs, ands, and buts about it. But
how about the slag walls?
That is up for discussion still. I mean, personally, I like the slag walls. They're pretty cool. But if they're going to continue to poison Silver Bow Creek, I'd say they need to come out. There was recently a study done by Chris Gammons, which looked at it, it looks like the walls themselves don't really leach much, but there are tailings under parts of the walls. So now we're gonna go back up to this old part. So the Berkeley pit's up here. Here's the, that's the Civic Center. Here's the Parrot tailings themselves, this kind of whitish area. Here's the diggings east down here. So this is the old Silver Bow Creek, now called Upper Silver Bow Creek. This has been battleground between Montana Department of Environmental Quality and the EPA. The EPA, in their record of decision, said the parrot plume's up here. Since the record of decision, the state's done more work with the help of Montana Bureau of Mines and Geology, and they believe the plume looks a lot more like that. So here's Blacktail Creek meeting Upper Silverbow Creek. And from the record of decision, there was a letter from then Director Richard Auber, and it says, the areas of disagreement between our agencies have been extensively documented in previous state comments. DEQ does not concur with the overarching decision to leave accessible major sources of groundwater contamination in place. We refer specifically to the Perk, the Diggings East, and the Northside Tailings. Our concern is that leaving these wastes in place poses a significant and permanent threat to groundwater and to the long-term water quality in Silverbow Creek. And I guess to be fair, I do need to explain the way EPA looks at this. They don't think the plume moves, and they think they can capture all of that groundwater, and it would be a huge cost to remove the Parrot, the Diggings East, and the Northside Tailings. Then we have a group that came along called Restore Our Creek. This is a citizens group, and it's actually a coalition. So it involved a lot of different citizens group, and they came up with a vision for that area. They hired a firm out of New York to take in all of the public input we had and kind of put legs and a design on this vision. So here we have the Civic Center, and we have some form of Silverbow Creek. You can see it's not very specific, but along Silverbow Creek there would be ponds. We would have lots of amenities, and it would be called Silverbow Creek Headwaters Park. So now I'm going to move on to stormwater, which is by far the worst problem. This is Harrison Avenue, and so this is what that storm channel looks like when you have a pretty good rain. But the remedy started back in the early 90s by capping wastes, reclaiming these wastes. So here we have the diamond, and here we have the diamond, more like today. So you might ask, why are these still left that way? Well, that all drains to the Berkeley Pit. So it's not a worry for Silverbow Creek, and parts of this will be left as a mining U-ship, which personally I don't mind. I don't know, maybe it insults some people, but you know, we did get some amenities, there's a walking trail, but this is what reclamation stops, is this kind of water going directly to Silverbow Creek. That was probably the worst problem besides the mine water going directly to the creek. So when is a street a stream? Well, when it rains hard, because what was just maybe a gully, it had a lot of vegetation on it, now it's been replaced by roofs and sidewalks and streets, and they're impermeable, so all of the rainwater gets concentrated and flows to a storm sewer system. And our storm sewer system was built quite a long time ago. As a matter of fact, we were named, this county government was named as a responsible party under Superfund, because our storm sewer system took ARCO's wastes from the hill to the creek. You can see here, again, blue staining on one of the underground. That's copper salts. So here's what it looks like in regards maybe to like a, you know, a watershed. So it's become part of the watershed. Blacktail Creek becomes Silverbow Creek. Here's Upper Silverbow Creek. But then you have all of these trunk lines, storm trunk lines, coming down and meeting the creek. So there's what the channel looks like when long after a rain event, there's only a little trickle of water in it. It doesn't have any flow in it when it hasn't rained for a while. And that's what it, again, looks like after a rain event. This picture was, I stole this from Fritz Daly. I love the football scale. Yeah. So what's happened? So this is Fish, Wildlife, and Parks. out doing their backpack survey, the shocking survey, they count fish. This guy stuns the fish with his little wand, and these guys collect them and they put them in a cage and they count them and weigh them. So this is what we first saw. I'll go through this quick because I got to move. This is a sculpin. Those are suckers. And these came in, these were there right away. They're fairly tolerant species. This was the next thing we saw in LAO, where the Colorado tailings was. This is quite a few years later, and that's a brookie, and that's a big male spawning brookie. And I love this picture. I got quite a few pictures, but the brookies are coming from Blacktail Creek. Matt Vincent used to catch fish up in Father Sheehan Park when he was a kid, so there's been brook there for a long time. This is Joe Notton. He did a master's thesis counting fish from Father Sheehan Park all the way down to Durant Canyon, and he's holding a cutthroat just downstream from Butte. So the cutthroat are probably coming out of either Brown's Gulch or especially German Gulch. German Gulch has been isolated from the poisons in Silver Bow Creek for a long time. It's been a barrier to migration of those fish. So now they have a lot better water. And that is Trevor Selch. He's a fish biologist with FWP. This is in Durant Canyon. And that guy came out of German Gulch. So they still move back up there in the summer when there are many stresses on the fish. From warm water, and for a long time it's been nutrients coming out of our sewage treatment plant, but of course including copper. So they've done surveys every year, they find that the fish take refuge in all three places, German Gulch, Blacktail Creek, and Brown's Gulch. So clean enough? Well, here's a little science for you. You have to bear with me. Starting back here in 1970, before Superfund, we had a man named Spindler who was the first environmental manager for the Anaconda Company. And they were going to do some changes in their operation that should affect water quality. So here's the before data, these two data points. Here's the after data point. You can't really see much because you have a normal scale for concentration. This is in parts per billion. But if you change that scale to a logarithmic scale so it jumps by powers of 10, you can see what's been going on. So here was his before, here was his afters, and then we start in on Superfund. So here's where they've been measuring it, and here's the progress they've been making under Superfund. So let's close in on this part. Instead of looking at copper concentrations, because if I told you guys 5 parts per billion, what does a trout think? You don't. Heck if I know. So what you do is you have to compare it to a water quality standard. And the complexity is that the water quality standard changes with the hardness in the stream. So you take a sample and you see the copper is this. Well, the standard is based on the hardness at that time. But to simplify it, and this makes it really beautiful, is you just take the ratio between the standard and the concentration, and it tells you if it's above 1, if the number's above 1, bad. If it's below 1, good. So pretty simple. So here, this big spiky area is before they remove the Colorado tailings. We had immediate, huge results. And we've continued to have results. This is when they put in that sub-drain along Upper Silver Bow Creek. They were releasing a lot of water down the creek. Got to break some eggs to make the omelet. And so we get down to here. 2015 is the last I have. But actually, early part of 2015, they still weren't meeting standards. It's the same thing, so I'm going to go buy it. So how does... There's actually two standards we go by. So one is for normal flow conditions, and one is for when we have rainstorms. So when you have a rainstorm, you get this real spike, quick spike in flow, and quick spike in concentrations. And so fish can tolerate a higher amount of copper for a very short period of time. So they have something called the acute standard. Normal flow conditions, it's the chronic standard. And this, again, is put into the copper compliance. So here, below that line is good, above it is bad. Is what I did was I took, ARCO will be required to meet water quality standards almost all the time. They're allowed one exceedance every 3 years. So all I did is, okay, if I looked at the maximum compliance every year, I could plot that out. So here in 2011, actually, their maximum was okay, but not so after that. But if you look at stormwater, look at where it's at. It's way up there. And as a matter of fact, they will probably change part of this standard. It will look a lot better just by changing the standard. I'm not going to go into that because it's a long discussion. But I, as a hydrogeologist, do agree with that part of it, and I believe it will still be protective, but they still have huge problems. And this is the other standard. This is based on the other standard, which will be dissolved instead of total recoverable. But this was a particular storm event in 2013. And here's what the rise in the creek looked like. So here's time along the bottom. This is 24 hours. So here's the spike in flow. And here's where they started measuring concentration. So again, this is the compliance ratio. There are 5.5 times the standard. Even if they changed the standard, they were 5.5 times the standard, and it's steady, well above the standard for 12 hours. Here's what it looked like coming down Upper Silver Bow Creek. It went to 10 times the standard, but they do not have to meet standards in that channel. So here's another little piece, and this involves our sewage treatment plant. So here's the sewage treatment plant, and here's where they discharge the water to Silver Bow Creek, right there. I'll remind you that they just upgraded the sewage treatment plant, and I think it's doing a fantastic job on nutrients, which it was meant to do. It's still questionable about what it's doing for metals. It is showing improvement in metals, but I don't know that it's good enough yet. But this is a separate story. This is about stormwater. One thing that you should understand about the sewage treatment plant. When it rains, they get a big spike of water as well. So Fish, Wildlife, and Parks said, they actually did this all along Silver Bow Creek. They said, we're gonna put little fingerling fishes in cages and monitor them over time. And we'll monitor water quality daily. And we're gonna see what happens to those fish. So they had one site that was upstream, and they had one site that was downstream of the sewage treatment plant. So here's the story. Again, I have dissolved copper along this axis, and these are every 2 days. This bottom blue line is water quality, is copper concentration, is copper compliance above. The orange line is copper compliance downstream. You can see we had a couple of big spikes. We had a rainstorm right there. Strangely enough, everything downstream died, everything upstream lived. And that's, you know, it would be a clearer story, but I gotta be frank that there was also a huge spike, a lethal spike of ammonia in the creek at the same time. So it must have pushed a lot of poorly treated water out into the stream. But what did it? The ammonia or the copper? Well, who cares at this point, but we better be damn sure that copper is under control. And right now, and I had a long argument when I worked for DEQ about recognizing that this copper is likely because the storm sewer system and the sanitary sewer system was probably buried in waste. either tailings or waste rock, because it was an available material to backfill with. So, managing groundwater in perpetuity, what does that really mean? And like I said, for this particular site, it means geologic time. So I've always wondered what kind of institution should we trust with this? And I know one institution that has a pretty long history, although this is the Catholic Church, and I'm sure the Serbians would say, no, man, it's the Orthodox Church.
Of course it is.
See? But really, in reality, it depends on us guys. You know, I can't say yous guys, because it's us guys. Because we live here, and we care about this place, and we care about that creek. So this is one organization that is hell-bent on getting this story out to everybody that lives on the Clark Fork. And that's why I started out my talk with my CEQA shirt on. The backside talks about protecting stormwater, so don't put oil down the storm drains or anything else, because it goes to the creek. So really what this is about is we need the next generation to be the stewards of all of this. And we also need them, even if they're not the stewards of this, they need to go out into the world and understand the story that Butte has. And this is part of Indian Education for All. These are Butte High students. And they got, when Tony Incashola was here, he worked with the high school students. There were some other people, and they built this fish trap. And of course, then we, you know, I don't know if we'll ever have bull trout back again or not, but we should always hope so. But interestingly enough, and this is when I worked for DEQ, there was a group that was suing DEQ. They were called the Headwaters Coalition. They were suing the state to take hopefully more action in that upper Silver Bow Creek area. And they said, you guys should not be calling that Metro Storm Drain, because the name was never officially changed. And so they took us to court. And actually, I wrote the affidavit supporting where DEQ was at. But in the end, Judge Newman ruled on it, and he said it is a waterway, and he said you should call it Silver Bow Creek. But I thought this language in there was particularly appropriate for us as citizens. In this case, plaintiff stands in the shoes of the government. It is seeking, as a private attorney general, to force the state to act appropriately with respect to the state's waters held in trust for the public. Powerful words, huh? So, that's it. Does anybody wonder what that is? Can anybody tell me what that is? She's got the key.
It's a split image of...
Yes,
is it the pit?
Yes,
Cyrus?
It is. Oh, wow.
Oh, wow. Oh,
turn the other way.
It's the reflection.
Cool.
Very good.
So it's 1 o'clock if people have to leave, but I'll stick around.